tell you that everything is everything.
Everything is everything.
Everything is everything.
Everything.
After winter must come spring. Everything is everything.
Yo, 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 yo. Our philosophy possibly speak tongues. Beat drums at the Sanneh Young Street Baptist. Rap this and find linen from the beginning. My practice extending across the atlas. I begat this, flipping it together on the dirty mattress. You can't match this, rapper slash actress. More powerful than two Cleopatras. Bomb graffiti on the tomb of Nefertiti. MCs ain't ready to take it to the Serengeti. My rhymes is heavy like the mind of Sister Betty. El Boogie spars with stars and constellations. Then came down for a little conversation. Adjacent to the king, fear no human being. Roll with cherubims to Nassau Coliseum. Now hear this mixture where hip hop meets scripture. Develop a negative into a positive picture.
Now everything is everything. What is meant to be will be.
What is meant to be will be.
And after winter must come spring.
Sometimes it seems.
Sometimes it seems.
We'll touch that dream.
We'll touch that
but
dream.
But things come slow and not at all.
They come slow.
And the ones on top.
The ones on top.
Won't make it stop.
So convinced that they might fall.
Let's love ourselves and we can't fail.
Hello, afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us for this important session of Disrupting with Purpose, focused on next-gen philanthropy. I'm super excited about this topic. We have a wonderful panel here today, wonderful artists who will be joining us very soon. One of my favorite, Brittany Delaney, who will share a piece for us customized for this specific session. We do a lot of work in our community around philanthropy. And one of the things that always comes up is how do we engage young people in philanthropy? How do we ensure that philanthropy has a legacy that we can build on that addresses equity and community issues? And we have a wonderful panel here that has really been in the depths of exploring topics around philanthropy and innovation in philanthropy, an innovation that centers younger adults in the conversation. Clearly, we need to go younger as we think about addressing all issues in our community, and philanthropy is one of them. So this is the beginning of this discussion, not the end of the discussion around next-gen philanthropy. This event series is supported by the great behind-the-scenes work of Claim Our Space and Katie Troyer. So I just want to give a shout-out to Katie and Claim Our Space. If you're looking for a host of an event, please look to them. And with that, I'll turn it to our wonderful MC, Miss Lissa Jones, host of KMOJ's Urban Agenda. Check her out Thursday evenings, as I always like to recognize the work of Urban Agenda and that you do. Hello, Lissa.
Thank you, Marcus, so much. I'm so grateful every time you introduce me to be your friend and colleague, and I thank you, Youthprise, and everyone who's watching for attending today. I am honored to be the MC for this event, and will try to do my best to do as little talking as I can, because we're really not here to hear from me. We're here to hear from the panelists. Now, I don't think that Brittany has been able to join us yet because of some technical issues, so we hope to hear from her at the end of our discussion today, so we won't miss her performance that was curated just for this experience. We're excited to hear from her. So in the event that we can't hear from Brittany now, let's go ahead and get started and welcome Aretha, Aretha Green-Rupert, for her fireside chat. She's the program director at the Carlson Family Foundation. I'm so excited to be at a fireside chat with you, Aretha. How are you?
I am doing good, Lissa. It's so good to see you.
Oh, thank you. That's completely mutual. All right. I promise not to talk too much. So let me drop a question, if I may.
Okay.
As someone who's been involved in philanthropy for several years, and as the current board chair for the Minnesota Council on Foundations, what do you see as major challenges for families and family foundations in continuing the legacy of philanthropy?
Thanks, Lissa. That's a great question. I think that's one, as Marcus even started out, that the field is wrestling with and really thinking about that, particularly our family foundations and as generational wealth begins to transfer. I think the things we always see when we have multiple generations involved, there's a traditional way of doing things. And then the next generation comes in that really wants to upend that and to do different innovative things. We have definitely seen that throughout time. And this time is no different. And definitely because people are living longer, we see a lot of our very traditional family foundations have multiple generations at the table, which I think makes for an exciting time because you're getting all these different perspectives. But when I think about some of the challenges and some of those tensions, it really does get down to the heart of what we've always done as compared to where we want to go next. And definitely that's next generation, our millennials, our Generation Z, they see things differently. We know this, their experiences are different. They're much more global in how they think, how they want to be engaged and involved is very different than the generations before them. So we've seen a lot of that disruption happens as the next generation, you know, they may not want to fund the same organizations. They may want to look at different organizations that are BIPOC led, more grassroots. The way they think about impact may be very different. Not very traditional ways. How do we kind of open this up? Who are those voices at the table? So I think we're going to see a lot of those shifts and a lot of those pushes that happen. I think back last year when Mackenzie Scott gave out $6 billion, very different than any other kind of philanthropic group has done. There are folks who applauded that. And there are some folks who were frankly kind of nervous. Will this upend what we know as philanthropy? And I think we have in this moment, and we talked about this reckoning in philanthropy as we've all dealt with the past year and a half, are we really looking at the things we've always done and taking a critical eye to say, yes, good things happen, but can we do better? Can we talk about equity? Can we talk about racial justice? Can we talk about, you know, whether or not we're giving out 5% or more than 5%? Are all of the notions and things that we've put in place, can they be pushed on and look different? And I think as we're gonna hear from some of our panelists, we're seeing some of those things show up where the next generation is saying it can look different. It doesn't have to be this way. We can do good in the community, but we can also do it differently. So I'm frankly excited to see where the field is headed and those younger voices coming into it.
This is exciting. It's a time of reimagining. Of really sort of creating perhaps a new way that philanthropy shows up in the world. This is fantastic. By the way, I just want people to know I'm taking copious notes. So when I'm looking down, I'm listening intently. I just need to remember these things. Aretha, as a Black woman in philanthropy, you established the Ivy Foundation. First of all, congratulations and thank you. And what are your thoughts about equity in philanthropy? And what can we do so that in 10 to 20 years down the road, there are more people of culture sitting at the head of philanthropic tables and participating in leading discussions like this one?
Yeah, that's another great question. I think it's one for sure at MCF, the Minnesota Council on Foundations, we've talked a lot about this. How does equity show up in this work? And I will say diversity, equity, inclusion has been a conversation that's been happening in the field for a while. And we've now expanded it to talk about what does it mean to be an anti-racist organization as well? And what does it mean to lean into the spaces of racial justice? I think for me, a couple of things come up. I think the point of how do we start to get younger people into the field of philanthropy is one that's always top of mind for me. I always joke that I've never met anyone who told me they want to grow up and go into philanthropy, because most people have no idea what it is. Even my own kids until the pandemic had no idea what I did every day, but they sat here and listened to me do all of these calls. So part of this is how did we get younger folks engaged and involved? I know that Youthprise has an opportunity for younger younger students to do grant making. I know Minnesota Women's Foundation also has opportunities to bring young people into grant making. So part of this is, how do we bring different voices in at a younger age so they even understand what this whole concept of philanthropy is, so they don't kind of stumble into it. Most people come into philanthropy when they're much older at different points in their careers. But how do we start to build that next generation of folks who want to go into it, not just with their own family wealth, but also as professionals in the field? So I think it's, how do we start to build that pipeline? I think it's also those diverse voices that we bring into our foundations at all levels of that. We talk a lot about, what does that look like? There's definitely program staff who uses that first interaction out to the community. We definitely talk about what those diverse voices and lived experiences, why that's important. But I want to challenge us to look at every level of our foundations. Where are we looking at the diverse voices in operations, in investments, in finance? Where are we investing all of these very large endowments? Are we thinking traditionally? Or are we going outside the box? Are we looking at different fund managers from different backgrounds? Really, are we putting to all the capital that we have at our disposal out there to really live into and lean into equity? And also at the very top level, at the trustee level, at the board level, how are we having those conversations? You can be very diverse with the staff, but if the board looks and feels the same, have you missed an opportunity? And I know that's more difficult in some structures, but you could have advisory groups, you could be bringing different people to the table to really help you think about, how are you making your decisions? How are you bringing those community voices to the table? Who are you listening to? Who are you engaging with? So there are lots of different things that we can look at throughout our structures. And I think the other thing I've thought a lot about, particularly being in philanthropy as long as I have, is that, what does the next generation of philanthropy look like with people of color? We know from statistics that people of color give more proportionally based on the income that they have. But have we thought about what the legacy of that begins to look like? Are we creating foundations, our own, you know, our own foundations? How are we taking our wealth to build legacy for our children and for those next generations? I know we have folks on here who have created foundations. And how do we begin to think about that? What does our legacy of giving look like? We can be at the table of traditional philanthropy, or we can start to create a table that looks and represents the people who want to be represented in this space. So I really am excited about, how do we have those conversations with folks? Right now, we know there are wealth gaps for people of color, but we also know there are more people of color who have wealth, more wealth than they've ever had. How do we begin to harness that, to leverage that, to create that next generation of foundations that are not only have people working in it, but the money also represents those families? So I think there's lots of things to think about when we think about the table. How can we really disrupt the table and have different people at it and be a part of it? And I know there are some efforts that are happening. We have the Philanthropic Collective to combat anti-Blackness and realize racial justice, which was created by some of our philanthropic peers around here who are people of color. But how do we again start to open that up? And I think there's so much opportunity in that conversation.
I have to tell you, I always try to take away something from my experiences. For you, I have many takeaways, but one of which is, nobody ever grows up and says, I want to be in philanthropy. I never thought of that. So what you're really talking about is shifting, busting, not messing with something that's old, but really creating something new that reflects where we want to be and how you want to show up in the world, not while honoring the older traditions.
Yeah. I think you can do both. I think they can happen together. And I think that's part of where there's some of the tension that we're frankly feeling, is that it's not, when we talk about sharing power and shifting, it's not saying that we're going to destroy everything that's happened. But you know what? It is big enough. The room and the table is big enough for lots of folks to come to it. And how do we begin to open that door up where folks not only come, but they feel welcome and that they're heard and that their voices matter in this space?
Well, I'm delighted to have had this chance to have a fireside chat with you. Aretha Green-Rupert, Program Director of the Carlson Family Foundation, and so much more. Her biography is in the chat. Check her out. Thank you, Aretha, so much.
Thank you, Lissa.
Oh, I'm very grateful. I learned so much. And now it's my pleasure to introduce artist and spoken word artist and arts educator, Brittany Delaney. Brittany is here to join us, and I'm just delighted to introduce you. Welcome, Brittany.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, all right. Can everybody see me? All right, sorry, having some difficulties there. Here we go. My grandmother was a wealthy woman. We were told to say it with a Southern twang because all the stories about where it came from had roots that stretched several miles south of the Mason-Dixon line, and they were complicated. But she added so much sugar, you would have thought she was making sweet tea. She always told us that money talks, and oftentimes it tells the stories of those whose hands it left and those whose hands it will never see. And the reason you wash your hands after is because money is dirty, even when it gets you clean. And the only way to remove the residue is to give. And giving is just as complicated as this tea. And that tea is just as hot as the South. And the South is sometimes too far for folks like us to reach. So we reach to those who are close enough for us to touch. See, my grandmother wasn't the type of wealthy you could spend. She was wealthy because she knew that reach was none of her business. Her business was simply to give. And that story raised me. The text reads, generational giving patterns are often shaped by economic, social, and political context that defines each group. The words means we give according to our stories. My friend's father was a proud man. Every time I came over, he would sit in his chair and tell me, sit down, Britt, I want to invest in you. He never told me stories about how he came to his current comforts. He never spoke about money. Instead, he told me the bed was made for him, inherited pillows with matching shams that had pleats. He told me his job was to share the blankets here and there, but be sure to preserve the sheets. She often went to galas I couldn't attend. Something about plus ones and brown paper bag tests. Old money had rules and guidelines and parties that had color lines. She and I would play dress up in her room. This would be the closest I would come to her world. She would put envelopes and pens on the tables and tell me to write my secret in there and put it into a box. Like this, she would say, as she looked curiously from side to side before dropping the letter into a fancy piggy bank. Now it'll go to a big corporation, she laughed. Her father didn't trust hand to hand. He said giving a dollar to the homeless was to give a dollar to the liquor store. I saw her make the same comment on social media not long after we turned 24. We give according to our stories. My grandfather only put his trust in one place, the church. He said, man will fail you every time, but God was infallible. He was the first 10% from his check and oftentimes his last dime in his pocket. He told me stories that could only be described in hymnals, each verse holding unforeseen circumstances and stormy weather, and the chorus where religion provided shelter in the rain. As his friends nodded in harmony, he'd sing, the church opened doors when the world closed them. The kingdom of the Lord was no charity. We give according to our stories. It is the question, the answer, and at times the problem. Some authors never knew the pain of an empty stomach firsthand. They never saw bare cabinets and empty refrigerators. Some authors never knew what it was like to pound on a glass ceiling. They don't know what it's like to have cuts on their hands while wading in the water. Some authors never had to write their own stories. They never knew how hard it was to cross the redlining or how difficult it is to erase the stain of systemic oppression. Some authors never knew what it was like to come from wealth that had to plan attached to it, the pressures handed down from relative to relative to ensure business as usual from generation to generation. The real gap in our interest is in each other's stories. We don't have to relate to them to hold space for them. Politics, social justice, churches, charities, GoFundMes, volunteer work, advocacy, equity, stories. The text reads, generational giving patterns are often shaped by economic, social, and political context that defines each group. The words mean, we give according to our stories. As we prepare to inherit assets from our parents and grandparents, may we also inherit pens to fill in the gaps that separate us. Thank you.
Wow. We give according to our stories. Brittany, that was really incredible.
Thank you.
Oh. I wish that I could ruminate on that. I hope that, well, I'm glad this is being recorded. Thank you, Brittany.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Oh, that was outstanding. No wonder Marcus said you're a favorite. Thank you. I don't know anybody who can listen to any of that and not be moved. We give according to our stories, and our gap is the interest in each other's stories. Oh, our poets are so powerful. You're getting amazing love in the chat, Brittany. If you can't see it, I will make certain that we figure out a way to get it to you. Thank you so
Thank
much.
You. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to bring our panelists forward. Their bios are also in the chat, and we will hear from Tony, Julia, Andrew, and Sam. Welcome. Hi, Tony, I can see you. And there you are, Julia. Hello. Andrew, hello. And there you are, Sam. Welcome, everybody. I'm delighted you're here. I am going to go right down the list of questions as they've been given to me. So please just take them in that order. And my paperwork starts out with Sam. Sam, welcome.
Hey, thank you so much for having me here, Lissa.
Thank you. I'm delighted you're here. You've recently taken over as the board chair for the Mardike Foundation. As you look at the legacy of your predecessors, what would you say you're most proud of concerning the foundation's work?
Yeah, so, you know, I want to start off by thanking everyone for having me here as a guest. I feel honored and such a privilege, especially hearing from Aretha and Brittany's work. You know, for me, hearing Brittany's piece touched upon my connection to MARDAG, which was started by in the legacy of my great-grandmother. And, you know, her directive was very broad in a lot of ways, in that her interest was around youth and elderly and supporting those in need. And I know that's been interpreted a variety of different ways throughout the generations, but that's something that I've been really proud of, because if you look at our focus areas today, our work is still very much grounded in the needs of those who are underserved, children, families, elderly, and the arts today. But this is something for me that I've, you know, I have obviously a family connection through. I watched my mother serve on the MARDAG Foundation board from the time I was a child, and was questioned, you know, what are these meetings you're going off to, and what is this work that you're doing? And, you know, that was part of my upbringing. And so today, as the board president of the MARDAG Foundation, you know, I approach the work very much from a place of being a teacher. And for me, you know, my background as a teacher, teaching in public schools here in the Twin Cities for the last 10 years, it was not because I felt like I was an expert in the area of history and, you know, the social sciences, but rather that as a student, that I got to learn alongside my students and create a culture of learning. And so as a board president today, you know, I'm still very much approaching the work as a student and wanting to learn, wanting to be challenged. And for anyone who's watching here today, I encourage you to please reach out to me and, you know, have a conversation and challenge me in the work that we're doing.
That's a tall call to order, I'll tell you. I think about when I work with city institutions, they are often in planning. They're planning for eight people who are eight and people who are 80 in the same time, because they often have needs that are similar. So your grandmother had the right kind of vision, planning for the young and planning for the elderly. As part of your vision moving forward, what are you doing to build upon that legacy? And what are your concerns philanthropically?
Yeah, so, you know, from the time of the board's inception, we had it as a value to bring in community members as part of the board. And that's something I'm very proud of. And I think today we've really kind of doubled down on that in terms of our balance of members. It's almost equal family members to community members. And, you know, my being invited here today was through one of our board members, Marcus Pope, who I'm so honored to sit with on the MARDAG board. And really, speaking of being challenged and, you know, around my thinking and my experience on the MARDAG board, my approach to leadership on the board. Sorry, I'm getting some feedback.
Tech, can you help Sam, please? Because my mic is off, so I don't think I'm feeding back. We'll try it again, Sam. Excuse
I'll try
me.
It again.
Thank you.
Sure. Yeah, so to have that, you know, our community leaders participate on the board is something that I think I'm both proud of, but feel needs to be essential or critical in what we do and the direction that we go. So, you know, the way I envision us moving forward is continuing to both not think just about how we wield our power, right? Like, obviously, we have a tremendous amount of power in our ability to use wealth and give to various organizations and charities, but how do we build that power and share that power? And so Marcus and I have been learning more about power moves. Not sure if any of the other panelists here have been have learned about this tool, but it comes out of the National Committee for Responsive Philanthropy, and you know, has us really taking an evaluative approach to the work that we're doing. Again, not just how we are giving grants, but who we are inviting to participate on the board, how we do that, and build a board that reflects our community and the needs of our community.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Sam. Thank you for sharing your experience. I appreciate it. Andrew Dayton, welcome to you. As someone who has witnessed and been engaged in philanthropic efforts, what do you see in this domain that resonates with you? And how is the field of philanthropy, in your experience, missing the mark?
Well, I'll just start by echoing my appreciation for the invitation. And I feel lucky to be on this panel with such accomplished people, and really grateful to Marcus and the team at Youthprise for pulling this together. I'm a big fan of him and them and their work. You know, I think there's a lot that is resonating with me right now. You know, I think I've started the organization that I run called Constellation about 3 years ago. And even over the course of that time, I've felt a real change in the receptivity to change in philanthropy. I think in part that's because of the challenges that our communities faced over the last several years. So that's the hard part of this change. But I think the silver lining is folks are really embracing the fact that what we've been doing clearly hasn't been working well enough, right? This is the most charitable state in the country in terms of dollars given and hours volunteered. And despite that, when it comes to poverty alleviation, which is what our organization focuses on, we obviously haven't made the progress over the course of generations in terms of closing some of these gaps. And so, you know, I think there is this, and you know, Aretha pointed to this in her remarks as well, this opportunity to think differently, which is something that I'm excited about. And as a lot of folks have already pointed to, one of the things that really resonates with me is this momentum towards looking to the community, to those who are most impacted as the experts on these challenges, which is something that our organization is working to do, and I can share more about how we're going about doing that. So to me, those are really important steps forward. I also see a lot of foundations thinking about how to give more, right? I mean, this in many ways is the rainy day. And so how can we be investing these resources that we have with a sense of urgency? So there's a lot from my perspective that is really compelling about what's happening. I also think there's areas for opportunity or things that might be missing the mark. And you know, I'll speak from my own experience. You know, I come from a lot of privilege. I've never experienced poverty, but I'm consistently approached as an expert on this issue because I have resources to give. And I think that is a fundamental paradox in philanthropy, is that those who are often furthest from the challenge are those who have their hands on the steering wheel when it comes to allocating precious philanthropic resources. And again, I think there's more and more conversation about that happening right now, but it's something that we at Constellation are really structurally committed to in terms of building an organization that is trying to, in a way, remove that connection and turn resources over to evidence about and from the community about what's working best for the community.
I am learning so much. From your perspective as a next generation philanthropist, what else would you say needs to change? I'm thinking about the trust gap, the belief gap, that the community is as an expert in its own experience. How did you deal with that?
Yeah, and again, I think that for us and for, I'm sure every foundation is a work in progress, right? There are 650,000 people experiencing poverty across the Twin Cities. So one in five residents of our community. And it is next to impossible to hear every one of their stories, right? There's never going to be a town hall forum that is big enough to accommodate each of those stories, each of those perspectives, which isn't to say that we shouldn't be committed to getting as close to those learnings and conversations as possible, which is frankly an area where our organization has more and more work to do and is committed to getting stronger and stronger. But one of the things that we've really focused on is, you know, how can we use different types of information to help inform decisions in a way that is representative of large groups of people experiencing specific challenges. And from our perspective, a big part of what we're doing is trying to update the use of quantitative tools, right? Data and research to help inform our investments, our donation strategies based on all of this information that is available to us as citizens of this community, in many of the same ways that organizations, businesses around our community are using these types of tools to inform their own decisions. I'm looking at Tony here. I mean, there's every professional sports team in the country is using more powerful analytical tools to try to fill their rosters than I would argue than we as a community are to try to understand some of these really complicated, vexing, scaled problems. None of which is to say that that's a solution, but I think it's a toolkit that hasn't been fully explored. And as someone who, again, perhaps as a next generation resident of this community, has seen the power that those types of information tools can wield in terms of understanding and addressing complicated challenges, part of what we're working to do at Constellation is to not only get stronger at listening to those whose experiences are closest to this challenge, but also using information that's available about the lives of hundreds and thousands of and hundreds of thousands of people navigating different challenges to try to inform our grant making in ways that are driven by evidence.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Thank you. Okay, Julia, welcome.
Hi there.
Thank you so much for being here and thank you for your patience. Tell us a little bit about your foundation, please, and the challenges that you face in carrying out the legacy that was established by the founders over 50 years ago. That's a lot of tradition.
And that is a lot of tradition, which is both good and bad. Well, thank you. I just want to say my thanks as well to all of you at Youthprise and all of the organizers and that amazing spoken piece by Brittany. That was really, really powerful. Well, so the history. So the Mayhad Fund of HRK Foundation was established in 1952 by my grandparents, Bill and Betty Hewlings. I was elected president of the board in 2012, but I first came on the board in 2001. And for years, I was steeped in the tradition of quiet giving to what we considered their generation's legacy, what had become mostly robust and familiar arts and cultural organizations of the Twin Cities and the St. Croix Valley, a little bit in Wisconsin. My grandparents thought that if you believed in an organization, you believed that they knew how best to run it. And so general operating gifts were the best way to reflect that confidence. May had established long-term relationships with its grantees, years of conservative general operating support, keeping the lights on, keeping the doors open were most important. This was the status quo for some time. Fast forward to 2015, and we still tried to give deference to the people doing the work. And we'd gradually expanded beyond the dominant narrative in directing our funding to include reproductive justice, HIV, AIDS, housing, indigenous rights, food justice, and immigration. But by not examining the connection between these issues and our country's legacy of denied and stolen opportunities, we were faced with the reality that we were continuing to participate in and contribute to structural and institutional racism. Unfortunately, it took the killing of Philando Castile to dislodge our passivity. And at the start of 2017, we adopted one singular guideline that all future grant making would be viewed through the lens of racial equity and inclusion.
I want to say thank you, Julia. I am struck by the number of times I'm speaking with people nationally, authors, and now you who talk about Philando Castile. I think it's important that people know that his mother is still here. And thank you for that recognition. Julia, what are you doing now to address this? Can you tell us about the new structure in grant making and the new issues you're addressing now that you decided to go to the one way of looking at issues? Or one lens, not one way, excuse me, one lens. Thank you.
Well, so we sunset the Mayhad Fund of HRK Foundation at the end of 2020. And the board is still going through a period of restructuring. But one of the challenges we face is, in addition to this passive participation in structural racism, we question the construct of hierarchy between the grant maker and the grantee. It's not our money. We are stewards, and the gift is being in service to others. Other than growing it, we can do nothing but give it away. Our only real challenge is to manage it so that we can be responsive, so that we indeed have the funds to give. An example to this end, we were able to give an additional unrestricted gift to each one of our grantees this past year in the wake of COVID. We see a challenge to a system of grant making that puts a burden on the organization. If we believe in the organization and therefore believe they know best what to do with their funds, why would we bog them down with redundant reporting, tie up their time and resources, hindering their ability to reach their goals, to fulfill an outdated construct with its roots in discrimination? If we're truly invested in the community, we're not always going to have the data. A lot of it is narrative. And neither are we always going to get the expected return. It's our challenge as grant makers to stay current with the organization. Our responsibility to educate ourselves, to ask pertinent questions. We've got to take the risks. We've got to stay invested. We need to focus on building the relationships. As grant makers, we can and should expect more from ourselves, and the community can and should expect more from us. We've got to give the money freely and generously and let the organizations do their jobs. I really believe that something better is possible.
I'm gonna say you're making me believe it too. Thank you, Julia. Disrupt with purpose. Oh, thank you, Julia. That is so, thank you. Thank you so much. And Tony, last but certainly not least, I'm delighted to welcome you to the panel today too. Welcome.
Thank you for having me, and thank you to all the guests and for all you do in our community.
Thank you so much. From your experience working in philanthropy, both independently and with family, what do you see as the keys to impactful philanthropy?
Well, I'm going to try to keep it real here. So, you know, I think, you know, first of all, you know, I think it starts with, you know, your heart and you know, thinking about others first and trying to really connect with the community, if that's what you're doing. I think you have to be purposeful about why you're doing it. And I think real philanthropy is, and I've heard it up here a couple of times already, you know, you're giving to give without real strings. And so you give because you want to, and you gotta be there because it's what you believe. And if we really believe that all of us are gonna be better off if everybody in the room is happy, it's really not up to us to decide what makes everybody happy. But we need everybody to have the tools that they need to thrive in this community. So, you know, I've tried to use my lived experience, I could say, to do stuff not traditional. I think, you know, one thing, as I heard before, is that the system hasn't always worked. I think we may lean on it a little too much because of this notion of best practices. So it's complicated, and you know, I would even test Mr. Dayton there a little bit. When people ask me sometimes, you know, like, how do I know when you're successful? I say, people call me, and I'm probably going to say you can measure that, which you can. But you know, when you're helping the community and they know it, you know, they call who they're getting feedback, who's making a difference. So I would say it's complicated. And it's nice to see, you know, in this community, so many people that believe in it and ultimately want to make this community healthier. And I think the key is, just as we're doing now, is sitting down in community and discussing it. And I think if we all do that with good intentions, we'll get there.
Thank you, and forgive me. Sometimes my mouse gets away from me when I'm trying to unmute. I'm taking notes. Thank you, Tony, so much. Next, what suggestions do you have for philanthropy to be more equitable and impactful in the future?
Well, like I said, I've heard it again. I'm repeating what some people say, and it's. I think we got to bring the community in it that we're serving. I think it's very hard, and your families or you personally have been large amounts of funds to the community with some people on here, but you're still controlling the money versus just giving it and then having it live in perpetuity with different people that get voted on by community in certain ways. So there is a level of control that I think has to be shared if we're going to be more impactful, in the community. And then we're all going to, we're all going to have to work on ourselves if we want to be more impactful, because, our biases contribute to a lot of things that we do on a daily basis. And, in my lived experience, I face it every day, and I love sports, and it defines who I was, but it is nowhere who I am, but somehow I always get tied to it. So really being open to look at the world in a different way today, and like we heard before, give the power to the people. So I think we have to share in that together. But also, there's a lot of people that have successes in a lot of ways, and sharing is a lot more than monetary. It's relationships, and a lot of the new research that's going to come out with youth is going to come out on measuring social capital. So are we sharing our networks? Are we sharing our experience? And I think that gets underestimated. And that is what relationships are all about. So we open ourselves to others. You got to lead top up and bottom down. And I think in the community, it's got to be that way as well.
That is disrupting with purpose too. Shared power. If we could, that would be very interesting to see how we learn how to share power. That's excellent. Would anybody like to respond or expound on anything that anyone else has said? We've got a couple of extra minutes, and I don't want to give anybody too little time. And not in a debate way, but in an informed, educational, share ideas in a small D democracy way. Thank you, Andrew.
Sure. One thing I'd add is I think something that Tony mentioned about, not just giving money, and something that we've been really focused on. Resources are, of course, important, and we need to, as folks have pointed to, give freely and with generosity. But there's also a lot of really amazing assets around our community that I think can be drawn from to help organizations do their work. We have a program that's taken off remarkably quickly that now includes about 15 companies, including some Fortune 500s, who are essentially allowing our organization to reach into their companies and build teams of pro bono volunteers to help nonprofits execute their work in effective ways and impactful ways. And we've designed it in a way where the nonprofit is very much leading the conversation. They are the expert in the room. I think we've heard from a lot of our grantees that they'd had pro bono experiences in the past that felt like a lot of work, but not a lot of payoff in terms of the support that it provided. So we've done our best to structure this in a way that draws from not just the resources of our community, but also the many, many talents that we have in our community to help organizations build databases and leadership training, legal support, accounting support, all these resources that we're blessed with in spades at all these amazing companies we have across the Twin Cities, but haven't necessarily been fully leveraged from our perspective to support the community in tangible and productive ways. So something that we're focused on, in addition to giving resources, is to making connections. And with that has come a lot of social capital from some of these companies. We have volunteers who are now joining the boards of our organizations or being invited to join the boards and whatnot. So making those connections, I think, can be almost more powerful than the resources themselves.
Can I just piggyback on that? It's so true what he said, and you would be surprised when you're working with people to solve a problem, how you develop a relationship, and then they decide to get more involved or tell more people are your biggest advocate. So, I mean, I think that's an amazing way to do it. And, you know, when we're running programming, you know, it's really hard to be intentional to focus on infrastructure, especially for a lot of organizations. Because at the end of the day, the line of kids not eating is not getting smaller. But when you get a resources in the form of an infrastructure, it really does make you healthier for the long run. And it's like telling a mother without, you know, with a dollar that she's got to go and buy healthy vegetables, but she's got to feed 8 people. They're going to, you know, think about how they're going to keep the kids from crying tonight. But if you can build that infrastructure, like you're saying, you really do build their social network and their capital. So I'm a huge proponent of that.
Thank you both very much. You know, I have been Black for over 50 years, and I've lived in Minnesota my whole life. And I have seen the degree to which money has been thrown at issues of people of culture. And yet we don't deal with the mythologies that create the problems in the first place that might eradicate the need for philanthropy if we really influence public policy and confronted the myths that inform philanthropy that result in the results we have today, which is not much moves in terms of the needle. Now, you may or may not agree with me, and it's okay, because I'm the moderator, so you can choose to do either one, but how do you feel? What might you think about that? That's just been my experience. And I've been in the foundation world, and I've been in the nonprofit side, and I've been in corporate America, but the needle doesn't seem to change, even though we declare a holiday for Juneteenth and George Floyd is no longer here.
You know, I very much believe in Tony's comments about the power of social capital. And, you know, my conversations with Marcus about, you know, supporting youth, not just through programs that benefit them, but by involving youth. And, you know, in a previous panel I sat on with Flor Frey, who we're going to hear from in a little bit, you know, she's had me thinking about how we prepare the next generation for philanthropy, not just within our family foundation. But as a teacher, I think, like, what are ways that we can get young people involved to think about philanthropy, not just for themselves, but for their wider community, and create engagement around social giving and create connections with people from their communities, people in positions of power, and continue to develop themselves and, you know, their participation in society. So those are the things I'm really kind of thinking about as a leader in the MARDAG Foundation, and how we can engage people from various sectors.
Thank you, Sam. Do you think philanthropy has a role in public policy? I mean,
I think it has to. You know, I think philanthropy in a way has to fully embrace the fact that there's simply not enough money in philanthropy to solve the challenges that we're trying to face here, right? And if we come to that, if we recognize that and fully embrace it, I think it forces us to ask different questions about what the highest order use of philanthropy can be. And from my perspective, it is part of an ecosystem, needs to be part of an ecosystem that has the chance to work at scale, whether that be through public policy changes that change systems within government, or part of a dialogue with the public sector about trying to identify and uplift and bring to the full potential different types of programs that are shown to be working at a high level by those experiencing those programs. So I think that philanthropy, in order for it to be part of a solution that can really take hold at the scale of the challenges that we're facing, needs to embrace the fact that this is not a solution in and of itself. It is part of an ecosystem that has a chance to really move things forward if it inserts itself into that ecosystem in the right way.
Thank you so much. Julia, do you think that confronting many of the difficulties that are true from historical realities contributed to the need to reassess how the foundation is structured and the way that it moves in the world. Do you think that that was a direct result of this reflection?
No, we were actually dealing with a retirement of our fabulous executive director, Kathleen Flugel, and a sort of geographical movement of our next generation. And so it just felt like the right time to step back and to consider what the next structure, you know, how we will be restructuring. So we're just still in the midst of that.
Thank you. And Tony, what does it mean when you center on community? When you say people call me, how is that a measure? Please explain for people who might not be familiar with our culture, the culture you may call and the culture I call, calls are important. What does that mean?
Well, you know, if we're down the street, if you're having a tough day and somebody says, hey, you know, call that guy, they can help you, or call that organization, or go somewhere, right? It's because you've made an impact on somebody's life enough to tell somebody else that you're a solution. And so when you get those phone calls and you know that somebody told them to call you and why. And, you know, we work a lot, and we just, you know, hired some new staff with our external affairs because we were so, you know, focused on trying to bring the money in to do stuff. But realistically, like we have to be honest, like my Instagram page is probably focused on different people than we're serving than are trying to come to the gala. So how do we, you know, touch base with people at a grassroots level and do enough in community where they know? And now, you know, during the pandemic, we fed our families, and then all of a sudden people started to just join the line because, you know, they knew we weren't going to say no. And my staff is working on saying, they don't say no much, they just say maybe not now. But there's no short of need. So we like to be called, as sad as we are that there's challenges, we like that people trust us enough to ask us for help. And also in this community, I think it's really important to make people feel okay to ask for help at any level, right? I think we've made it such a big deal to be strong, and it's caused these mental health issues. And, you know, during the pandemic, I think it was the first time where it's actually okay to ask for help for food, but we know the need's always been there, right? But now it's okay to ask. And so we're happy when people trust us enough to ask for help, and we do what we can, or we try to point them in the right direction if we can't support them.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, many, many years ago, when I was a much younger woman, I used to have the opportunity to be a part of a team that advised Virginia McKnight Binger about her private giving of the McKnight Foundation. And she used to drive around. It was kind of crazy because I was like, I don't know if this is safe. We were in a big, very fancy car, and she had on very fancy clothes and coat. And she would say, drive around the city and let me talk to the people. And I'd be like, oh my, this is going to be kind of okay. So she would stop at bus stops and other places. And she would say, when you need help, where do you go? And I mean, honestly, she would get in the car and she'd say, okay, if two people say that, I'm going to want to give them money. And that has always struck me, that she was that close to her own philanthropy, even though she had this huge, you know, she could have had a staff of thousands of people if she wanted to do the work. But she went out and she asked the people, where did you get help? So when Tony said, they call me, that struck a personal resonance with me. So thank you, each of you, for sharing your experiences and your wisdom and your insights. We're very excited to have had the opportunity to learn from you. To those people who are in the chat with questions, we will be back at the end of our time with questions, so we won't forget you. And Sophia's helping me with that. I now have the opportunity, thank you, panelists, to introduce, Flor Frey. And I'm excited to sit down with her for just a few minutes and to talk with her about her reaction to the conversation, more to ask her about what she thinks. Flor, welcome.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi, thank you for being here and thank you for your patience today.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me. I'm humbled to be here and really, really happy to be with you all.
Well, thank you so much. I want to ask you, pose a question and move out of the way. What are some of the reactions you have to what you've heard based on your experience?
Yeah. Well, one is I can just relate to every single one of the speakers that shared from their perspectives today. I mean, resonated with Aretha and Andrew and Sam and Julia. And, you know, this is hard. The next gen topics are difficult and challenging. They're complex, as are some of the takeaways that I took from this conversation. Aretha talked about, you know, there's this dynamic of traditional kind of legacy, you know, work that's happened, and a new rising generation and new ideas and different ways of doing things. And there's a healthy tension there. And from the Frey Foundation perspective, we're a family foundation, having worked in the community for over three decades in housing, education, and health and human services. And, you know, we're three generations working alongside one another, and that brings differing perspectives and generational views. And, you know, those are great things. And there's also times when there are points of tension as well. And that's just the reality. And so, you know, I think that, you know, just listening to all of the panelists share their experiences, you know, this is the time for, I think Andrew talked about receptivity or open hearts and minds to doing things a little bit differently, where perhaps because of the environment in which we're working with, you know, operating within a health pandemic and the racial reckoning that has occurred, you know, the things that have been held on as truths in the past are just no longer, right? And so this is a time for trying new things. There's permission to do things differently. And so I think that's, it's a great opportunity for us as next gen folks to take this opportunity to do things a little bit differently, because there is that permissibility, that receptivity, like Andrew talked about, to try things a little bit differently.
Thank you. That was very thoughtful. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much, Flor. And now I have a chance to welcome Wendy Lovell-Smith to share your perspectives and your reactions to what the other panelists had to say. Welcome, Wendy.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. I'm really honored to be part of this conversation. I've lived in this community for 23 years. I moved here from New York, and I just wanted to say that this conversation that we're having and why I got involved with Youthprise is because youth voices are at the table. And I'm honored to be working with Youthprise. And one of the things that attracted me to the organization was that they were listening to youth. And in our family, one of the things that's really critical is using our Jewish values to think about how we give. And as Marcus knows, we've included our family in lots of conversations. We have four children, and we're trying to now include them when we think about next gen philanthropy. I want to speak about our personal experience. Our children sit at the table with us and listen. And, you know, in the beginning, you know, they're from 22 to 14 right now. But one of the things that's been really important is what they watch. They're watching us. They're watching what we do. And so I think it's really important to have those conversations. I love what Aretha said specifically about, like, that no kid says they want to grow up and go into philanthropy. That really resonated with me, you know. And I love what Brittany said about we give according to our stories. So we need to tell those stories. I want to remember something that happened in sixth grade at my kids' Jewish day school. The kids have to write an ethical will, and they have to think about what do you care about? What do you value? What's meaningful to you? So this is an exercise that the kids did at their school, and it was really, really eye-opening. And that started when our kids were much younger. But that got us thinking about how are we going to bring our kids to the table when we think about philanthropy? So, you know, when we started having our kids think about helping us think about how we give, we asked them to give us ideas. At first, they started saying they wanted to give to all the things that we cared about. And then the next year, they came to the table and started bringing us lists of things that they cared about, what they were seeing. For example, my daughter saw with COVID, the mental health crisis. So, you know, we're going to go on a visit to Washburn. You know what I mean? So I think that what I think is so important is, like, if we want to train our kids to be the next generation and the next transfer of wealth, we need to start including our kids and having them be at the table. And that's something that I wanted to talk about personally, because that has been so critical to us. So a lot of what we heard is so important. And I think it's also important to listen and to make sure we're listening to all the right voices. And what Andrew was saying and Tony was saying about social capital, you know, it's critical. If we're going to have equity, we have to listen and have people sitting at the table that may not be like us. And we need to make sure that all voices are heard. And we have to give people experiences. It's not just about giving wealth. It's also about what we do. They're always watching. And that's what I always say. So
I am struck by the idea of an ethical will in sixth grade. What if we all had to come up with an ethical will at sixth grade? I wonder how we would change as people. That's really profound, Wendy, bringing your children in. How would you say you think it has changed how you and your husband affect philanthropy?
I think they're having them at the table and having their, you know, them thinking about what is happening in their world around them and being, you know, exposed and having experiences in community, I think is critical. I'm hoping, you know, you said that, you know, no one grows up and goes into philanthropy. One of my kids is actually thinking, she's a senior in college, she's actually thinking of having a career now in Jewish communal philanthropy. And I think she never even thought of that before. But I think part of it has to do with the fact that they are now thinking about it. And I think we have to have those conversations with our families. It starts there. I think it's critical.
Thank you so much, Wendy. Oh, this is wonderful. Thank you so much. And it reminds me, I need to go grab my grandchildren to get them involved. Yeah, that reminds me, I do. Thank you, Wendy, so much. I appreciate that. That's exciting news to think about our children as philanthropists and people who are ethical and showing up in the world. It's fantastic. Hope abounds and I need it. I don't know about anybody else. I'd like to thank Flor. I'd like to thank Wendy. And I'd like to welcome the panelists back for a bit of Q&A. That will be Sam and Julia and Tony and Andrew, welcome back. All right, from Larry, what evaluation tools should a foundation use to ensure the money that they are distributing is doing the most good? Should the foundation consult with grantees concerning the tools that should be used? And if you're comfortable using the raise hand, or if you just like to raise your hand so that we don't talk over each other, you're not talking over each other. Julie, thank you.
Hi there. Well, Larry, we are and really focused on the relationships that we create with our grantees, and the lunches and the chats and the phone calls and the texts and the just really staying involved. So I think that for us has always felt like the most organic way of deciding where the funds are best used, but that's really the organization's that's there at their discretion. But just in terms of the success, I think we see that reflected in the types of relationships they're able to display in the community, and what types of we just stay as connected as possible and try to be approachable and similar to Tony, but in a different, obviously in a different dynamic. Want to be always considered that they could just call and you know, pick up the phone and say, this is what we need, and this is what we're doing, and this is what we see happening. They know the job best. So as a grant maker, I'm not in a position to know where that money is best used, where that money, what's going to be the most effective. The folks working in the organization know that. They have that experience. They have those ties and that strong connection to the issues.
Thank you, Julia. Andrew?
Well, first of all, I'd agree with Julia. You know, I really applaud giving unrestricted funding. I think that's something that we should be seeing more and more of in philanthropy. It's something that we do prioritize. You know, and I also want to take Tony's point. He gave me, I think, a fair shot earlier. You know, none of what I'm trying to argue for is is to say that exactly what you're pointing into in terms of these key sort of unmeasurable parts of the work have to be front and center in any decision philanthropically, right? That you can't measure the sense of security a mother feels knowing that her child is in a after school program. And so, you know, there's a lot that can't be captured there. You know, I would also say that from our perspective, with some exceptions, most, you know, a lot of foundations have pointed to the fact that there is a role for data and research in philanthropy to help inform decisions. And from my experience, oftentimes the information that's being used in that way is sort of points to the output versus the outcome of the work. How many things did we do? How many people did we serve versus what actually happened in the lives of these individuals as a result of this work? So, you know, we do take an approach that works to balance the unmeasurable with that can be captured through evidence. And from our perspective, what it's really allowed us to do is find organizations that we wouldn't have maybe otherwise realized the power of their work, right? They might not have a well-connected board or throw the best parties or you know, have a fancy website, but their work, when you really sort of understand the lever that it's creating, is too powerful to ignore. So at least from our perspective, using the sort of the stories and the science has been how we go about trying to identify the organizations that we partner with and then do everything that we can to support them through unrestricted funding, through these partnership opportunities and whatever else we can to help them move forward in their own work in a way that they know better than we ever could.
Thank you very much. From Noah, what action steps are your organizations taking to bring younger voices and this new generation of folks to the decision-making table? How are you working to set young people up for a successful future based on their needs? And same process, please.
You know, that's a great question. It's one thing that I think should be a priority for us. I don't have the answer. I can tell you that one of my first years as a teacher, it was a question I brought to the rest of the board. What would it look like if we brought in some of my students to participate, maybe through, you know, a smaller version of a board or a committee or an advisory panel where they both had that kind of exposure, as well as the experience of giving and learning about philanthropy. And, you know, for a number of reasons, it was not the right time, but it's something I think needs to be. I think it's extremely important and want to see it happen. So again, I will point to other boards that have done that. I think, Flora, isn't that something similar you've done within your own family, have created smaller types of grants available for family members or the next generation to use and dedicate?
Yeah, we've created a carve out to involve the younger generation in getting them to actually participate in the grant making efforts by rolling up their sleeves and actually making grants and evaluating organizations and visiting with organizations, getting to know the philanthropic community. And so it's a way for the younger generations to get involved. So we've carved out a specific fund for them.
Excellent, thank you. Congratulations, Flor, that's making it a verb. From Mary Sue, there are some amazing models that focus on social capital building. Is this a future focus for grant making?
I mean, I think it is, but, you know, I think, and I would go back to Andrew, is like, we can measure this stuff, and I think it's really important, and now they're starting to come up with, you know, metrics around, you know, social capital that work, and you're seeing larger investments because we know, you know, it makes a difference. We also, in theory, know that larger investments in early childhood education, you know, have a high ROI or past data. So, and this is why it's important for people not to like do programming in silos, because you learn what works, you learn what's effective, and believe it or not, Andrew, I'm a big proponent of data. But I also think that when you make your investments, you kind of got to use it like you do in the stock market. And if we're only looking for baked programmings with great outcomes, we may miss just good people and great ideas. But I'm here internally with my staff, you know, the first thing, you know, I have to manage a budget. So again, I'm probably putting my foot in my mouth half the time. Because I'm like, all right, what do you need and what are we going to get for it? Right. And because I got to make tough decisions and sometimes, you know, some of my staff members will just come up to me and said, they just need it because they need it. And so we really try to like, I can't run the whole organization that way. And then you find out things like early childhood or social capital and you look at what your vision is and what your alignment, how it aligns, because there's some great investments that just maybe isn't what you do, right? Like, you know, we may not, you know, we're not like, we don't recycle water. Like that's just not something that we're gonna ever probably do. We might advocate for it to give youth a voice, but so we have to look at, does it fit in with our guidelines and what, how we can help? Because we'd rather be really good at a certain portfolio and do that. But we want to be really good at social capital. So yes, we are investing in learning more about it. More, we're already doing it. I guess we're learning more how to measure it so that we can make decisions on how to structure our programming to get a better result in that fashion.
Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Anybody else? Okay. Lakora, what does it look like for philanthropy to share power with community? What does sharing social capital actually look like?
I think to the first part of the question, you know, we have an open and competitive grant process, which is somewhat unique for a family foundation. And we also restructured our meetings to have half of them dedicated to learning sessions. So it's really important for us to hear from and interact directly with our grantees, hear about their experiences in the field, what they're seeing, what they're thinking, what the needs are of those that they're serving, and have that relationship in place so that, you know, if that's one way we're connecting with community, we invite people in. We also conduct site visits as a function of our service on the board. We're not... you know, we don't serve full-time. It's not our full-time job. We're all volunteers. We're working another job. So it's something that is, you know, a challenge, but is also a value of ours. And I think both in sharing power on the board with community members, that's fundamental to, I think, our health of the board.
Well, thank you, Sam, very much. Aretha, are you back with some knowledge?
They brought me back in. Thank you guys. I'm learning so much just from the panelists. And I would just want to echo what Sam said. I think the question around sharing power, and this is one that we've talked a lot about, and what does that begin to look like and how do you bring community in? And I think it's all those things. I think the big part is how do you learn and how do you listen to community? I know at MCF, we've talked a lot about this around this, and this concept has come up. What does proximity to community? So when you gave your example with Ms. Binger, you were literally in the community. What does that mean when you're talking about a grant maker of understanding your community, going out, having those conversations, and really starting to align the grant making, not as to what you think may be what the needs are, but they really are aligning with what you're hearing on the ground, the conversations you're having, what you're having with the nonprofit. So really it's digging down deep into the areas and challenging some of your assumptions, because in philanthropy, we have a lot of assumptions. And have we tested those out? Are we really doing things that align? And if we find out that we're funding some things or we're pushing efforts that don't align with the community, how do we shift? How do we make and change course thoughtfully, respectfully, but really starting to keep our grant making align with what's going on? And you only know that when you invite the community into your conversation and really to learn from them, not just to come and say, here's what we're gonna do, and we're just gonna tell you, but how do you listen? and really take all of that in.
Excellent. Wendy, you talked about listening. Would you like to add something? You're back too. I'm glad to see you.
Oh, thank you. I think it's very important to have many different voices at the table and also ask the questions that need to be asked, and also ask who's not at the table, who should be at the table, because sometimes I think that's often missing. So, and I think as we grow and learn from everything that's happened in our city, I think that that will be critical as we move forward to invite more community to sit at the table with us as we make decisions going forward.
Excellent. All right, next up from Kia. Does it make sense for granting organizations to work together in areas where their organizations intersect as a way to pool their resources to make a greater impact? Excellent.
I would respond that yes, of course it makes wonderful sense for that. The downside could be that some of the sort of historical tendency had been to use the club feel of grant makers, that you could sort of leverage the name of a foundation to get another foundation to give support because they took the risk, they're putting their name out there, so you should too. And you know, that obviously has its benefit, but it just only perpetuates this idea of this construct of hierarchy, in my opinion. So I think a more positive approach is to, rather than use the community, the foundation connections as a way to reinforce those tropes, so to say, but to really use, like knit the foundations together, be out in the community that you're serving so that you can, you know, perhaps one particular, you know, we all know that what doesn't fit our program area, but we know another foundation that does. And so it is our imperative to make those connections and bring the foundations together with similar interests or similar guidelines, so to say, to that community that's asking for the funding, but do it in a way that really promotes healthy and transparent relationships rather than that sort of hierarchical approach that I mentioned was historically used.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to weigh in? Some head nodding going on, just affirmation? Okay, Julia from Antonio, how does your foundation decide who to grant funds to? And from any panelist, do you all fund social entrepreneurs? And if so, how do you identify them?
I'll just quick answer that we have some guidelines on our website. And at this point, because we're in this period of restructuring, we're not accepting new requests. We are working on continuing to support our current grantees through COVID and working on some long pledges that still need to be finalized. So we're sort of in a holding pattern, but like I said before, that we adopted this racial equity lens, so to say, not necessarily a new program area, but that we were going to start looking at, you know, really what that impact was going to be in terms of racial equity and inclusion. So that's what I can say about our particular set of people.
Thank you. Other panelists? Social entrepreneurs? Okay. How do you envision a true partnership or collaboration between the public and foundation communities? Do you have a vision that you'd like to share? Okay, let's go Tony and then Andrew.
You know, I've seen some families start to do this, and you know, I got questioned at an organization once and said, well, who's on your board and are they representing the community? And I was like, well, actually in Minnesota, you know, all the C-suite people, the majority of are not people of color. And the ones that are, we have this responsibility to be on every board because we're like unicorns. And then if I'm trying to raise money, I actually need people that can actually bring social capital and finances to the organization. Whereas family foundations really don't, because they already have the resource. They just need the expertise. So my dream would be that, you know, more and more family foundations offer community seats to their grant making process in sharing that. And you're starting to see it, which is really refreshing. And then, you know, I always say, you know, looking at our boards, it's a tough question, because we're saying like, yeah, we want you to have representation, but we're also saying that you have to raise the money to do it, and in this climate. So what is the real representation for our adult community, not for the kids we serve? Because if all Black people were police officers, we'd have none left to be lawyers, teachers, and doctors. So it's got to be, it's got to go across with the same ratios as our demographics on our boards as well. And so we live in Minnesota, so you know, that should be our demographics are our demographics.
Demographics have a lot to do with it, Tony. You're right. And Andrew, thank you, Tony. Andrew?
Well, on the public policy piece, you know, I think it partly depends on the foundation and or the nonprofit and, you know, the role that they play in the community. I think that will define the role that they could play with a public partner. But, you know, I spent a couple of years working in San Francisco for the mayor's office out there. And there's a version of our model in San Francisco. And this is when I became really passionate about this work. And in the mayor's office, we were often looking to external resources like this organization in the Bay Area to help us understand problems that we didn't have the, you know, you're in an executive office like that, you're drinking out of a fire hose of the day-to-day rush of running a city, and to be able to work with philanthropic partners who had done a different level of diligence, community diligence, and also in this case, dive into the evidence to make the case for why a given program deserves to get dramatic new funding from the city, right? There's an example. Another sister organization of ours in New York was one of the first organizations anywhere in the country to fund needle exchanges at a time when that was politically untouchable, right? But they saw the evidence for it, and they were able to sort of show, based on an objective read of the efficacy of that program, that despite being controversial, this was something that was creating dramatic improvements for health and wealth for people who were experiencing addiction. And so they don't fund that program anymore now because the federal government does. And to me, that is an opportunity for philanthropy to try things, to understand things in ways that government isn't able or built to do, and to turn those learnings over to government to help then bring to a scale that philanthropy can't. And from our perspective, that's, you know, part of the role that we hope to play in terms of how can we be part of, you know, for lack of a better term, being the smart risk capital in the community, which in effect is what philanthropy can be, to help turn those learnings over to our friends at the public sector, who again are the ones with the level of resource to bring a good idea to a level beyond philanthropy's reach.
Thank you, Andrew. That's very, very thoughtful. Thank you very much. As we move to wrap up, I just want to make one quick announcement. If you follow Youthprise on Twitter or Instagram, and you are, I guess, among the first to do so, there is a Soul Bowl gift card in it for you. And if you haven't had Soul Bowl, you will find new soul at Soul Bowl. So if you do that and follow Youthprise, we're going to move to wrap up. Would you like to make any closing comments, panelists? What would you like to leave? Just give us a sentence or two. What's a nugget you want us to take away, please? And just if you do this again, that'd be great.
Sorry if I'm talking too much here, but I read a great quote the other day from Mahatma Gandhi, who said, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. And to me, that sense of losing yourself is what to me has been so moving about my own journey in philanthropy, is just really centering in the fact that this is not about me, that I don't have the answers. And if you can truly lose yourself in service to others, if we can all try to do that, I think we'll be in a much better place as a philanthropic community.
Again, thank you, everyone. Thank you, Youthprise, for allowing me to be a part of this conversation. I think for me, I've been kind of on different aspects of the nonprofit sector, both as a person who ran programs, as a person who has raised funds, and a person who is now on the other side of that. So I get the full spectrum of what this whole nonprofit sector feels like. And I think the thing for me about this moment, philanthropy, is if we're going to take a really, truly solid look at ourselves and all of our structures and all of our legacy and how we, you know, how we do our work, how we've been put together, and really take a critical look. And we can't really ask others to do that critical look if we're not doing it themselves. And we are asking lots of our nonprofit organizations, how are you doing work around equity? How are you bringing different voices to the table? And we have to also turn that mirror back on ourselves and ask ourselves those questions and be truthful that we know we have work to do. Lots of things have happened, but we have a lot to do, and that this is a journey. We will get things wrong along this journey, but we have to stay committed. We have to stay consistent and realize that at the end of the day, it really is about the community. It's not about whatever legacy we're going to move forward, which is great. But at the end of the day, it really is about those folks in our community for whom opportunities have not been there. And how do we kind of show up? We really want this to be the best community for everyone. How do we lean into that and actually mean that and bring those folks to the table, bring those voices to the table, that they are a part of the solution of creating them because they know what needs to be done, and they're centered in the conversations that we have.
I would just add with what the previous two said is, you know, we don't know, there's not like the magic pill that fixes everything. And we do have to stay committed, and we can't fix what took hundreds of years to build, to find a solution unless we are committed over time in investing in it. And so, and we also have to applaud each other and every once in a while and take notice that there's a lot of really good people that are really committed in getting this done. And so I think sometimes we always concentrate on what's wrong instead of saying, you know what, like there's reason for hope. And when I start to turn the page and how many people are on this Zoom, I'm like, there's reason for hope. There's a lot of us, and we'll get there if we stay committed.
Well, I would say, sort of in the spirit of my ancestors, a luta continua, the struggle continues, right? So thank you for your commitment to the work. Thank you for staying in the work. And thank you for leading conversations that center on young people and the people who are most impacted by the policies and decisions that are made at the tables that you sit at. Thank you for your commitment to sharing this with Youthprise. Thank you to Youthprise for this great opportunity to have this conversation. It's been vastly informative for me. If you are at Andrea_Witt on Instagram, you are going to Solvo, and they're going to DM you the details in order to redeem your card. In the meantime and in between time, I'll turn it back to Youthprise to say thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, panelists, and thank you, everybody who stuck with us through this time. We appreciate it very much. Marcus, am I kicking it back to you?
Sure. Thanks, Lissa, and thank you all for a wonderful discussion. Really insightful. I know most of you on the panel, and I've learned something just from this conversation, even though we've had several conversations previously. I think a next phase of this conversation is really to bring more young people to the table, Wendy and her children and others, to talk about what's the next phase of this work. Clearly, everybody on this panel represents the next generation of philanthropy and really building on the legacy of their parents and their grandparents. But we need to start early, and we need to get younger folks involved in philanthropy and foundations to really produce the change that we want to see in the community. That's the Youthprise way. You know, we'll be strong advocates for younger people being engaged and authentically involved in these efforts, and we'll continue to do that. But with that, we'll give you about 3 or 4 minutes back of your day. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, panelists, for a wonderful conversation.
The sun shall not smite eye by day. nor the moon by night, nor the pestilence that lurks in dark places, nor destruction that wasted that good day. The time has just gone.
When I look at where I'm coming from, I know I'm blessed, and I close my eyes and smile. Sometimes I feel like the richest man in Babylon, and I've done my best, so everything's alright inside.
Oh, every morning I rise, I stare at the sun.
I know
it is a blessing, so when the evening comes, I lift up my eyes to this. I'm blessed, oh man, with my two hands in the air as far as I can. Sometimes I'm lost and far from home, but I'll find my way. I follow my heart, I know I'll be found someday. While I'm lost, I learn and live. What do you say? Let's have a good time until that day.
Just one.